Hello learners, good day to all. This is Professor Vishal Sood from Central University of Himachal Pradesh, Dharamshala. In the previous lessons, we have discussed about teaching styles, teaching models, pedagogy and instruction. Today, we are going to learn about basic considerations for selecting an appropriate approach to instruction or appropriate teaching method. So our today's presentation will focus on teaching approaches, an introductory remark, basic considerations, what basic considerations must be taken by the teacher into cognizance while selecting a particular teaching approach or teaching method, what different types of teaching approaches are available with us, and then we will finally conclude this presentation. So let us begin with teaching approaches. A teaching approach refers to a comprehensive way of dealing with a particular problem. A teaching approach, you may also term it as a teaching method or instructional method. It is a general plan of action on the basis of which various methods and models are evolved and developed. That means a teaching approach is a wider term, whereas different methods fall under that. That means method is a narrower term. Approach is a wider term. An approach is a precursor on the basis of which a method is designed. And it is very essential that a teacher should impart education by following appropriate teaching approach. So now let us have a glimpse about what basic considerations must be kept in mind by the teacher while selecting an appropriate approach to the instruction or while selecting a particular teaching method. First, that is the grade level of the learners. Then learner qualities. Then the nature of the subject matter. Then intended learning outcomes or expected learning outcomes. Then the learning environment, the availability of resources with the teacher. These are basic considerations which a teacher must be kept in mind while selecting an teaching approach or an instructional approach. Now let us discuss these considerations one by one. First, the grade level of learners. As you are aware that when a learner is at primary level or when we teach at the primary level, we focus more on the activities. That means we try to adopt playway method or activity based method. Whereas at the higher level, at the secondary level, we don't try to use this playway method. We try to use either lecture demonstration, discussion method, project method, or many other methods. So the grade level of the learners, in which particular class the students are studying or for which particular class a particular teaching method is to be adopted, it is decided by the grade level. At the lower grade level, the teaching approaches will be different. Just like at the primary level, the activity-based approach is more emphasized, the playway method is more emphasized, whereas at the higher grade level, at the secondary level, we use the discussion method, we use lecture cum demonstration method. At the university or the college stage, lecture method is more dominant. So grade level decides which particular approach to instruction will be appropriate. The second basic consideration while selecting approach to instruction is the learner's qualities. A teacher must be aware about the learner's qualities. Now, what are different learner's qualities? We can classify it in different parts: the intellectual qualities or the intellectual characteristics of the students, the socio-economic characteristics of the students, the psychological characteristics of the students, the physical characteristics of the learners. These qualities or these characteristics of the learners also helps in deciding which particular instructional approach will be adopted or will be appropriate for the teacher to enhance learning or to achieve the learning objectives. Now, intellectual characteristics. If the learners in the classroom, they are of higher IQ level, the approach to instruction will be different. And if the students in our class, they are of lower IQ level, then our teaching approach will be different. Similarly, the socio-economic characteristics, to which social strata the students belong to, what are their economic level. Accordingly, on the basis of this, what type of learning experiences are to be given to them? It is to be decided by the teacher. And what type of learning experiences are to be given? On the basis of those learning experiences, the corresponding instructional approach will be decided by the teacher. Then the psychological characteristics. Although the IQ is also a part of psychological characteristic, but in psychological characteristic, the motivation level of the learners, the attitude of the students towards learning, the interests of the learners, these are also the criteria which must be taken into cognizance, which must be taken into consideration by the teacher while selecting a particular teaching method. If you are going to adopt, if the students have more interest or they are more motivated to learn through the field activities, you need to take those students to the field. So, your approach to instruction will be different. But if the students, they are not interested in the field activities or they are not have motivation to go outside the classroom, you have to follow that particular approach to instruction which will be compartmentalized within the classroom. Then the physical qualities. Now, if the students are, if any of the student in your class is physically handicapped, for such type of student, your approach to instruction will be different. If you are teaching specially abled children, your approach to instruction will be different. You are teaching visually impaired children, your approach to instruction will be different. If you are going for the teaching of hearing impaired students, your approach to instruction will be different. So the physical characteristics, they also decide which particular approach to instruction will be appropriate and is to be adopted by the teacher in the classroom situation. So this is the learner qualities is the consideration that must be kept in mind by the teacher while selecting an instructional approach. Now, nature of the subject matter. Which subject you are teaching in the classroom? It also decides which approach will be better, which instructional method or which instructional strategy will be better. But as a teacher, you must keep in mind that a content should be taught with multiple perspectives. That means whenever you teach a content in the classroom, you teach its different perspectives, teach it with different angles. Try to give different type of learning experiences to the students so that the students' characteristics, their individual characteristics, their individual experiences can be met out, their experiences can be taken into the teaching learning process and you can improve your teaching learning process. And moreover, if you will teach with multiple perspectives, if you will take the content with the multiple perspectives to the students, it will reduce the chances of the marginalization of the students. That means if you will not teach the content in multiple perspectives, sometimes the students feel that this content is not related to me. This is related to other students. And he feels marginalized in the classroom. He feels aloof in the classroom. So always teach the content in the classroom with multiple perspectives. Now, how do subject matter decides that which particular teaching approach or instructional approach will be better? As you know, in sciences, in the subject of science, which teaching method will be better or what type of teaching approaches can be used. That is inquiry method. In sciences, we use demonstration method, or in sciences, we use laboratory method. But when it comes to mathematics, the instructional approach or instructional method, it changes entirely. Now, we emphasize more on problem-solving method. In mathematics, we give stress more on drill and practice. We emphasize more on inductive and deductive approach, analytic, synthetic approach. And when it comes to languages, in English or in Hindi, you try to use translation method. You try to use drill and practice method. Grammar cum translation method is there in languages. Direct method is there. Direct method of teaching languages is there. So that means what subject you are going to teach in the classroom, it decides which particular teaching method or which particular teaching approach will be better to realize the instructional objective or to achieve the learning objectives. So nature of subject matter is also a major consideration while selecting appropriate approach to instruction. The other consideration is the intended or expected learning outcomes. The intended learning outcomes or expected learning outcomes, these are also the considerations while selecting instructional approach. Now, what do we mean by intended or expected learning outcome? Intended or expected learning outcome refers to the instructional objectives. You know that instructional objectives are set before the teaching starts. That means at the time of planning, the instructional objectives are formulated by the teacher. Now, for example, how do these instructional objectives or intended or expected learning outcomes helps in deciding which approach will be followed? Let us take an example. This is an instructional objective or intended learning outcome for science. Define gravitational force. That at the end of the lesson, the students will be able to define gravitational force. What we are expecting from the students? That at the end of the teaching learning process, they will define gravitational force. In order to achieve this learning objective or intended learning outcome, how you will follow the teaching learning process? That is the lecture method. So, through lecture method, they will understand the definition of the gravitational force. So your approach will be, or your instructional method will be lecture method. Now see the other objective. Demonstrate the presence of starch in potatoes. This is intended learning outcome. In order to achieve this learning outcome, which particular instructional approach or lecture or instructional method will be better? Here, lecture method only will not work. Here you have to use lecture cum demonstration method. So the intended learning outcome is deciding which particular method or instructional approach will be employed by the teacher in the classroom. Now see the third, again for science. Prepare carbon dioxide in laboratory. In order to achieve this, that the students will be able to prepare carbon dioxide gas in the laboratory, neither the lecture method nor the lecture cum demonstration method will work. Through these methods, the students will not be able to prepare carbon dioxide gas in the laboratory. So, in order to achieve this learning outcome, you have to follow experimental or laboratory method. Now, for mathematics. Measure the area of the floor of the classroom. That at the end of the lesson, the students will be able to measure the area of the floor of the classroom. To achieve this learning outcome, the teacher has to follow either activity-based approach with deductive approach. Then he can achieve this learning outcome. So the objective or the intended learning outcome is deciding which particular teaching approach or instructional method will be followed by the teacher. Then see another objective, another intended learning outcome, the last one. Differentiate between proper and common noun for English. Similarly, it can be for Hindi language, or it can be for social sciences. Differentiate between this and this. If you want that at the end of the lesson, the students will be able to differentiate between two things, here, which instructional approach will be much better? Here, lecture method with illustration, with examples, that will be much better to make the students understand about those two concepts, or to make the students the differences between proper noun and the common noun. So, the intended learning outcomes or the instructional objectives, they are deciding which particular teaching approach or instructional approach will be appropriate for the teacher. So, intended learning outcomes or the expected learning outcomes is a major consideration for selecting instructional approach. Now, learning environment is also a variable that influences the selection of a particular instructional approach. Now, what we mean by learning environment? Or learning environment of the school is comprised of what factors? School policies, teachers' beliefs and motivation. To what extent the teachers are motivated? Similarly, the students' beliefs and motivation. Whether the students have motivation level, whether their motivation level is higher, whether they are curious to know about certain things, whether the school policies promote the teachers for making students better understood or for innovation, whether the school policies are conducive for teachers and students. This also comes under learning environment. If the school policies are conducive, the learning environment will be conducive. The relationship among the school staff and the students, the relationship between the teacher and the students, this also is a deciding factor for the learning environment. Then, the physical infrastructure available in the school, the facilities available in the school, the teaching learning resources available in the school, these all also makes the learning environment, or these also influences the learning environment of the schools. Then, the learner's needs and interests. What are the requirements, academic requirements or the personal requirements of the students? Whether those learning needs are taken into consideration by the teacher or the institution, their needs, their interests are catered well or not. So, all these factors decide about the learning environment. And if the learning environment is conducive, the learning will be higher. If the learning environment is not conducive, the learning will be lower. So, a conducive learning environment will definitely motivate the teachers to follow better teaching approaches, to adopt such approaches to instruction which will help in realizing the intended learning outcomes, or which will help in achieving the expected learning outcomes, or which will help in achieving the instructional objectives. Now, learning environment of school can include school's goals, vision and mission. If the school's learning environment is positive, if it is caring, if it is supportive for the students as well as the teachers, and if it is meaningful, definitely the teachers will follow those instructional approaches which will help the students to enhance their learning, and which will help the teachers to make their teaching effective or give their best to the school as well as to the teachers, to the students. Then, leadership style of the head and teachers. The teachers are the academic heads. The school head or the principal is the administrative head. So, what type of leadership style they adopt in the classroom? If the leadership style of teachers, that is, the teaching style of the teachers is delegating, they will definitely empower their students. Accordingly, they will follow the instructional approaches. They will follow discussion. They will ensure more participation of the students in the classroom. Similarly, if the leadership style of the head is democratic, he will definitely give, he or she will definitely give chances or opportunities for the teachers to innovate, to experiment in the class, to give their best to the students. The students and parental participation in various school activities also decides the learning environment. If the parents' participation is ensured, the parents' say is acknowledged by the teacher and the school, then there will be better instructional approaches followed by the teachers and the school for betterment and for enhanced learning among the students. The students' monitoring mechanism, the students' evaluation pattern, the school's evaluation pattern, and the follow-up system or the feedback system followed by the school to provide remedial instruction or to provide remedial help to the weak students, or enrichment programs for the gifted learner. This also decides what type of particular instructional approaches will be followed by the teachers. So learning environment is also a major factor in deciding what type of particular instructional approaches or instructional methods will be adopted or employed by the teacher in the classroom. Another factor is the resources available with the schools. Now, we can classify the resources in two categories, the human resources and the physical resources. Under human resources, teaching and the non-teaching staff, the parents and the community members, outside experts, academicians and practitioners, and the learners. These are the human resources, and these human resources also influences what type of instructional methodology will be employed by the schools. If the teachers are well qualified, well skilled, there is a congenial relationship, a better relationship between the teachers, among the teaching and the non-teaching staff, definitely those instructional approaches will be followed by the teachers, which will enhance learning among the students. Parental contribution is there. The community participation is there in the school affairs. Definitely, the school has to be responsive to the parents and the community. And if the school wishes to be responsive to the parents and community, the school has to adopt those instructional approaches which are for the betterment of the learners. Sometimes the schools also invite outside experts, outside academicians from outside the school, or the practitioners who are in the nearby community to the school to provide different or diverse learning experiences to the students. If such type of practices are there in the school, definitely the school will adopt a different or a favorable instructional methodology for the learners. So these are the human resources. Now, whether there are outside experts or academicians available, or there is contact between the school and outside experts or academicians, if there is contact between the school and this, definitely the instructional methodology will be better. Now we come to physical resources. Whether technological or audiovisual aids or teaching learning material is available with the institution or not. If it is available, whether the teachers use those material or not, it also decides which instructional approach will be adopted. If the school is having smart classroom, or school is having the facility for using YouTube or online learning facilities, then the instructional methodology will be different. The library resources, the laboratory resources available with the school, they also influences the adoption of a particular instructional approach. If the library is enriched, the laboratories are well equipped, the teacher will adopt the instructional approach according to the availability of the resources which are available in library or in the laboratory. Similarly, schools, surroundings and local community. If the school is situated in such a community where there are chances for field visits or for experimentation, definitely the methodology adopted by the teacher will be different. And if there are no fields, or the school is located in a city where there are no chances of field visits, or where there are no chances of agricultural fields, then the teacher of a biology will adopt a different teaching methodology or a different teaching approach. Then Apart from the technological and audiovisual aids or TLM available with the institution, sometimes the teachers, they use improvised learning materials. When it comes to improvised learning materials, the teachers, what they do, they develop their own learning material on the basis of local materials available with them. So this also decides if the teacher has the skill to improvise, then he will adopt the teaching approach accordingly. If he is not able to improvise, he will use a different instructional approach. So available resources, the human resources and the physical resources, are the major factors that helps in deciding which particular approach to instruction will be adopted or employed by the teacher in the classroom situation. Now another factor which helps in deciding or selecting appropriate approach to instruction is the ability of the teacher. The teacher's mastery over the content matter. If the teacher is expert in his subject, in his content, he will adopt a different kind of methodology. But if we are not well conversed about our subject matter, we try to skip that situation, and accordingly our approach to instruction will be sometimes different. Then teaching skills possessed by the teacher. If I possess such teaching skills where I can use such instructional approach where the student's participation is to be ensured, I will definitely employ that instructional approach which is student-centered in nature. But if I do not possess the teaching skills of ensuring students' participation, I will adopt teacher-centered approach to instruction. And most important, you can see on the screen that a teacher must be equipped with TPAC. What we mean by TPAC? TPAC is technological, pedagogical, and content knowledge. A teacher must be having content knowledge, that is mastery over the content matter. He must be having pedagogical knowledge. Pedagogical knowledge means he must have knowledge and skills or understanding about different teaching strategies and methods available with us that he or she can use in the classroom situation. And a teacher must have technological knowledge. What type of technologies are available with him or her that can be employed in the classroom to make his teaching effective, to make his teaching better. So a teacher must be equipped with TPAC, content knowledge, pedagogical knowledge, and technological knowledge to make his teaching effective. And if a teacher is equipped with TPAC, he will definitely approach or employ that instructional approach which will suit the learner's needs, which will enhance learning among them. Now, what type of teaching approaches are available with us? Let us have a brief idea about these teaching approaches. First is teacher-centered approaches, in which the teacher is more active. Those teaching approaches or those instructional approaches in which the teacher is more active, the students are not so active, they are listeners. So these teacher-centered approaches include the methods like lecture method, demonstration method, and team teaching method. These three methods fall under the teacher-centered approach to instruction. Then learner-centered approach. Learner-centered approach is that in which the student's participation is ensured. The students are more active. The teacher is the guide. The teacher is the facilitator of learning. And in this learner-centered approach, the methods are inquiry method, problem-solving method, and project method. Then the third approach to instruction is group-centered approach, where both the teacher and the students are the part of the learning process, where the students work as per the guidance, as per the advice of the teacher on the group basis, and they work in a team. And in this group-centered instructional approach, the methods are discussion method, cooperative learning method, brainstorming method. Then another approach to instruction is there, which is technology centered or flipped classroom. Sometimes what happens in the classroom that we try to teach with Google or YouTube or other technological online apps or e-learning. So, and the teacher's role is very passive. We try to learn or we try to teach with these electronic apps or online apps. Such type of approach is technology-centered approach to instruction. Then flipped classroom is there. Flipped classroom means where the teacher prepares his lesson, presents it through online learning, and students come prepared about that lesson at their home and then come to the class, and the teacher and the student discuss about that lesson which they have learned at their home and which was earlier prepared by the teacher through online method. So that is flipped classroom. So this is technology centered or flipped classroom approach to instruction. About these instructional approaches you will learn in the forthcoming lessons. But these are the major four teaching approaches or instructional approaches. So learners, now I wish to conclude that you must keep in mind that one size fits all situation will not work in teaching learning situation. While selecting appropriate approach to instruction, you must take into cognizance or keep in mind that which particular approach will be better for your teaching. You have to see what type of teaching skills are possessed by you, what are the resources available with you, whether you are master over that particular content or not. These factors and the explained factors must be kept in mind while selecting appropriate approach to instruction and making your teaching effective, interesting, and a lively experience. And if you want to become an effective teacher, a successful teacher in your life, appropriate instructional approach selection is very essential for you. I hope you must have understood about this. Thank you very much.